Welcome to Morgellons Discussion and Microscopy Videos with your host, Jeremy Murphree.
Hey YouTube, and thanks once again for tuning into our show, Morgellons Disease Discussion and Microscopy Videos. I'm your host, Jeremy Murphree, and today I want to talk about the science that has been established about Morgellons and what has been disproven. You know, every time I get on YouTube or Facebook, I see somebody out there who claims that they know what's going on with Morgellons. It's a biological weapon and it's killing everybody. But they fail to read these right here. This is called a peer review. Peer review approved. Furthermore, it says, if you look, that it was accepted for publication, right? It was checked for plagiarism. That's true. Single blind? This is a blind controlled study? Yes, it is. So, now that we got that out of the way, what does this study say about Morgellons disease? Well, here's the abstract, and hang around because I'm going to read a lot of this to you. Morgellons disease is a skin condition characterized by the presence of multicolored filaments that lie under, are embedded in, or project from the skin. Although the condition may have a longer history, disease matching the above description was first reported in the United States in 2002. Since that time, the condition that we know as Morgellons disease has become a polemic topic. Clinical studies supporting the hypothesis that Morgellons disease is exclusively delusional in origin have considerable methodological flaws that often neglect the fact that mental disorders can result from underlying somatic illness. In contrast, rigorous experimental investigations show that this skin affliction results from a physiological response to the presence of an infectious agent. Recent studies, from that point of view, show an association between Morgellons disease and spirochetal infection in humans, cattle, and dogs. These investigations have determined that the cutaneous filaments are not implanted textile fibers, but are composed of the cellular proteins keratin and collagen and result from overproduction of these filaments in response to spirochetal infection. Further studies of the genetics, pathogenesis, and treatment of Morgellons disease are warranted. So, is this the first time you've heard about this study right here? Did you know that there's actually peer-reviewed, blind-controlled studies that demonstrate Morgellons as a result of an infection? The reason you may not have heard about this information is because there is a concentrated effort to bury it. There are people who want you to think that Morgellons fibers do not originate from inside the body as the study demonstrates. They want you to think that they are fibers that are dropped from airplanes that you breathe in and are coming out of your skin. But that's not what the science shows, not at all. They want you to believe that this is all in your head, that the fibers are nothing more than textile fibers you picked up from your clothes or on your bed sheets. But that's not what this says at all. People are ignoring the science. But the answer is right here, in plain sight, for everybody to see. In plain sight, for everyone to see. Who cares to read it? But they won't, because they want to keep control of the issue. Like the study says, there are studies which suggest that Morgellons is purely psychosomatic. That means that there are people who have invested time and money into proving that hypothesis. So what else is in this study that's of interest? Fiber analysis. Histological studies have shown that filaments in Morgellons disease tissue are not textile fibers, but are biofilaments produced by human epithelial cells and stemming from deeper epidermal layers, upper dermal layers, and the root sheath of hair follicles. Morgellons disease cutaneous filaments are predominantly composed of keratin and collagen, as determined by histological studies, and appear to be produced by activated keratinocytes and fibroblasts. The base of filament attachment to epithelial cells demonstrates nucleation that is continuous with that of surrounding epithelial cells, indicating that the filaments are of human cellular origin. Histochemical staining of the skin sections containing embedded filaments with Congo red resulted in apple green birefringence suggestive of an amyloid component. Cauliflower white staining of skin sections with embedded filaments was negative, and thus Morgellons filaments do not have any cellulose content from plant fibers, such as cotton or chitin, or fungal cells or insect endoskeletons. We know that it is not a fungus, but what else does this study tell us? Borrelia spirochetes can invade and replicate inside fibroblasts and keratinocytes, and have been isolated in vitro from monolayers of keratinocytes and fibroblasts despite antibiotic treatment. Sequestration in these cells may be a contributing factor in the development of refractory infection in Morgellons disease patients. In support of that hypothesis, Borrelia spirochetes were detected in Morgellons disease skin specimens removed from patients treated with aggressive antibiotic therapy. Hypothetically, intracellular infection of keratinocytes and fibroblasts would be able to alter keratin and collagen gene expression, respectively, resulting in unusual filament formation. Some patients report that gel was secreted from their skin. We sectioned these dry gel secretions and found immunostaining targeted to Borrelia was positive and demonstrated a copious quantity of well-formed spirochetes embedded in a clear matrix. This finding is consistent with biofilm formation. The spirochetal load in Morgellons disease specimens is high and suggests biofilm formation in vivo. The formation of biofilms may also contribute to the severity of the dermopathy and antibiotic resistance. But what else can we learn? Although there is anecdotal evidence that Morgellons disease responds to antibiotics, controlled studies of Morgellons disease treatment with antibiotics have not been conducted. Optimal treatment for Morgellons disease remains undetermined. Two of the authors report success in treating Lyme disease, Morgellons disease patients with antibiotics. In general, early treatment contributes to a better patient outcome. Treatment aimed at the underlying tick-borne disease is essential to resolve Morgellons disease dermopathy, and treatment may require both prolonged combination antibiotic therapy and the identification and treatment of any co-infecting tick-borne diseases or other exacerbating factors. Some patients benefit from antiparasitic therapy, although there appears to be no direct evidence of parasitic infection in Morgellons disease. But what else can we learn? This is a good one. I like this one right here. There is a significant overlap in the array of symptoms that may accompany Lyme disease, Morgellons disease, and mental illness, thus complicating the diagnosis. In theory, patients who do not have Morgellons disease but who are delusional could think they have Morgellons disease if they have had exposure to the topic through the internet or other means. To complicate the diagnosis further, Morgellons disease patients may exhibit neuropsychiatric symptoms and may have psychiatric diagnoses such as bipolar disorder, attention deficit disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, and schizophrenia. Therefore, many Morgellons disease patients may have psychiatric comorbidities, and in some cases, patients have been misdiagnosed with a psychiatric illness that they do not have. Some Morgellons disease patients may have false beliefs that are not delusional in origin. Lack of scientific knowledge can cause patients to misinterpret symptoms, such as the presence of filaments and sensations of formication as worms, arthropods, or other infestations. In addition, Morgellons disease lesions are sticky, and arthropods or artifacts can adhere to exudate, and patients may incorrectly believe these external factors are associated with the dermopathy. But what else can we learn? The DSM-5 does not mention delusions of parasitosis, delusional infestation, or delusional parasitosis. In fact, the case of delusional disorder, 297.1, delusions are not the beliefs themselves, but the way they are interpreted by patients. Delusions are profound, intensely held beliefs that seem barely swayed by evidence to the contrary, even to the point of believing in the bizarre. In contrast, the presence of human biofibers embedded in the skin of Morgellons disease patients is factual. The patients are not hallucinating imaginary fibers, and they are not implanting textile fibers or hallucinating an imaginary infestation. Morgellons disease is not a case of fixed beliefs despite the lack of medical evidence, because if fibers are present and they are visible under magnification, then there is medical evidence. Morgellons disease fibers projecting from and embedded in the skin may have elaborate configurations with branching, and the filaments may have tapered ends. Even skilled microsurgeons could not implant the fibers in that configuration. But what else can we learn? If you want to learn more, download the study. Check it out. Read it. It is absolutely peer-reviewed, blind-controlled, accepted for publication, and it's not screwing around. So if you see somebody coming up to you talking about the chemtrails, talking about the demons, the aliens, the GMOs, the madness, the mayhem, and the bullshit. Direct them to this study and tell them to kindly fuck off about your disease.